very much. So, very quick introduction to Madagascar. It's an island off the coast of Africa. When biologists hear the word Madagascar, we think amazing diversity, lemurs. 84% of plants in Madagascar are endemic. And for people in the conservation profession and for people in anthropology, Madagascar is a case study of human impact on the environment. So people arrived on the island for the first time less than 5,000 years ago. The Malagasy language has exported two words to the international vocabulary, and the Malagasy word lavak means a giant erosion gully. So many of you have probably seen television pictures of horrific environmental destruction in Madagascar, empty landscapes, no trees. When you fly into the capital city, Antananarivo, you will see erosion gullies like this. Lavakas, this word is used by the international conservation community, and a lot of sediment washing out to sea. In 2007, Kew Gardens, where I work, we published the Madagascar Vegetation Atlas. So in the east, the magical rainforest with the lemurs is a little strip of forest on the right-hand side. The spiny forest with its amazing plants is down the bottom. There's remnants of the western dry forest in the west. And the thing that concerns me is all this yellow space in the middle. And people have traditionally assumed that the island was completely covered in forest. People came, people pretty much chopped and burned the entire lot of forest, and now there's nothing left in the middle. I started working as a grass taxonomist in Kew Gardens in 2010, now 7 years ago. I did a brief survey of grass taxonomy around the world, and it quickly became apparent that nobody really has documented the endemic grasses of Madagascar, and nobody really knew what species grew in the middle of the island. People just assumed it was all secondary grass weeds that came over from Africa. So I'm going to tell you about my work during the last 7 years, where we've spent time trying to understand what is in the middle of the island, what species grow there, what are the grasses, and what is the environmental history of these landscapes. So this is everywhere we've gone in Madagascar for the last 7 years. Madagascar is larger than France, and traveling can be quite difficult. This is a fairly typical example of a road. I think I've managed to find about 260 of the 540 approximately grass species that are there. Working at Kew, I'm very lucky to collaborate with the Kew Madagascar Conservation Centre. So Kew Gardens is based in London, in Great Britain, and we have one offshore part of our organisation in Madagascar. We have 20 colleagues who work with us in Antananarivo. And together with them, we have overcome some exciting fieldwork situations. So this is a flood, and in exchange for $3, it's possible to get your vehicle across the flood on a little canoe like that. But my driver refused to do that, so in fact, we weren't able to get across the flood at all. And when grasses flower, they like to flower in the wet season, and roads in the wet season frequently look like this. So we collected all those grasses across Madagascar, and then I realized that there was in fact no molecular knowledge of grasses in tropical Africa, so we had to take a few side trips. This is the East African coast, and we got an extra 200 species around Kenya and Tanzania. So all taxonomists love to build phylogenetic trees. This is my big phylogenetic tree. All together, so this is every single genus of the family Poaceae, which are the grasses. It's a large plant family. There are about 11,000 species. summary of the work by Caroline Stromberg, and this is environmental change in continents all across the world. I'm sorry you might not be able to see it very well, but between 30 and 20 million years ago, grass-dominated habitats opened up on all continents: Central North America, Southern South America, Eurasia, China, South Asia, and C4-dominated environments appeared everywhere about 3 to 8 million years ago. So the American prairies are a typical example of this kind of environment. And to me, this suggested that a similar situation could be happening in Madagascar, even though it's never been documented. So these are our 71 radiations of grasses to Madagascar. So every line is one diversification of Poaceae into Madagascar. The black ones are C4. So grasses came to Madagascar 45 times, already pre-adapted to hot open canopy environments. And this happened approximately 3 to 8 million years ago. So grasses came to Madagascar at the same time as the Miocene grassland expansion. So this is still not published, and it's kind of big news, and it was a big surprise to people who worked in Madagascar, commonly just in rainforests. So now I will tell you a little bit about what kind of grasses came to Madagascar. The very first one is this Lepidoptera madagascariensis, locally known as the blue bamboo. Nobody could identify it, and it's quite endemic in the Andringitra southern mountain range. This is a typical forest scene in northern Madagascar in Marajej, and in fact the largest and second oldest grass radiation contains these little palm-like leaves there. It's a genus Poicylostachys in the forest shade grape. This is a puzzle for the audience. Can anybody tell me what this plant is? Madagascar plant quiz. Any takers? Well, this is obviously a grass, right? So have a look at this picture. This is the same thing, the pseudonym. And at the tip of every, so it's a grass pretending to be an erica. It has tiny little grass spikes on the end. It's very cute, but this is my favorite species. And it's endemic to the same mountain range in Madagascar. So this is the same place. And all of that pink stuff you see down the bottom is Panicum compressi, Panicum scopidifolium, which is a local endemic just to that part of the island. And now we jump to dry, arid southern Madagascar, which got a lot of problems with poverty and a lot of problems with overgrazing. So this is an overgrazed pasture where Nanja is doing her sampling. And the little Panicum, which is dominant here, is C4. And is in fact very similar on herbarium specimens to this Panicum. So this proved to be a fantastic case example of why alpha taxonomy is still necessary. So we were able to demonstrate to local botanists that this species can be differentiated from that one using specimen-based taxonomy. So my geneticist and ecologist friends were very surprised that I stare at dead plants stuck onto bits of paper, and in fact we define our species using dead plants stuck onto bits of paper. It's rather strange. Okay. So this is kind of a quick tour of different kinds of Madagascar grasses. Anthropogon, those are Malagasy blue stems, and we found 7 C4 species which are endemic just to bits of central Madagascar, kind of proving that this is a historically open canopy environment. This is a rather sad case of an extinct grass, Sartidia perrieri, collected just once, 100 years ago, and never seen since. We've searched for the species for a long time. And now, this is a theoretical ecological framework. And during the last part of the talk, I'll try to explain how we think about the grasslands of central Madagascar. Are these natural ecosystems, or are they secondary anthropogenic ecosystems? new and strange for them, but for any Americans who work on the prairie, it's self-evident that a prairie can become degraded and secondary, and the prairie can appear quite similar to what happens after you burn a forest. But in fact, it's possible to tell the difference between a natural prairie and a degraded one. My summary of the similar work done from tropical regions suggests that high grass endemicity marks ancient grassland and savanna. In Madagascar, grass endemicity is only at 45%, much lower than 85% for other dicots, but for grasses, endemicity is still very high. The shortest person on this slide is our MSc student Nanja on the day she got her distinction, and she documented 35% endemicity in the area we were working in South Madagascar. So I'll skip over some more ecology work. We did some plots. Phylogenetic diversity of ecosystems across Madagascar suggests them to be natural. Endemicity is high. We think there's 217 Poaceae endemics across the island. Grasses came to Madagascar about the same time as the Miocene grassland expansion, and we're still working on the ecological methodology to differentiate ancient grasslands, so I'd be really interested to hear about equivalent work in the prairies if anybody has experience. Look out for our new book, which is currently in press, Madagascar Grass Identification Guide. Okay, and I'd like to say thank you to everybody who has helped. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maria. We have time for about two or three questions.
Are there any bamboo type grasses in Madagascar?
Absolutely. 37 native endemic bamboos. There's two native radiations, and there's also a few common introduced and weedy ones. I didn't have time to include them, unfortunately. So I have a PhD student who just started his work with the Chinese Academy of Sciences, trying to look at them in more detail.
How neat. And are there any interesting animals that eat them?
The bamboo lemur.
Cool. Okay.
Yeah. It would be nice to say that the bamboo lemur is desperately dependent on endemic bamboos. The truth is the bamboo lemur doesn't care. It eats anything. Invasive bamboos or plants.
We're done with the questions. Thank you, Maria. Ms. Jack.